Hello everyone. Today we're going to look at a relatively new API added to OpenXR called the Rendel Model Extension, and the support we have for this in Godot. As a developer, we may not know what hardware the user is running on. The user may be using hardware that didn't even exist when we developed our app. Imagine developing for Quest on a Quest 3, but now your game is playing on a Quest 4. Or imagine developing for SteamVR or AndroidXR, which can work with a multitude of hardware. For VR, it is often immersion-breaking if the incorrect hardware is shown in applicable places. The Rendel Model Extension attempts to solve this by providing an API to obtain assets that are correct for the hardware being used. At the time of making this video, this only focuses on controller models, but the API is designed to make other models available as well. SteamVR currently has the most complete implementation, and this is what we are using in this video. We're also using Godot 4.5, which is the first version of Godot with support for this new API. I've already prepared a simple project that enables OpenXR and sets up a basic XR player setup. I'll link to a beginner tutorial video and the source of this project in the description. We need to start by enabling render models. Open up Project Settings and find the OpenXR section. A little down, we find the Rendel Model Extension. We need to tick this to enable it. Bringing in render models themselves is really straightforward. We need to add a new node to our XR Origin 3D node. When we search for render model, we will find two entries. OpenXR render model is a node that will display a single render model obtained from the XR runtime. The node we want is OpenXR Render Model Manager, which will react to new render models becoming active and display those. With just that in place, we can see our controller models automatically being displayed. As you can see, not only are they displayed, the models automatically react to inputs. As I press the grip button or push the face buttons, even the joysticks, you can see that they move accordingly. It gets better. On OpenXR runtimes that support this functionality, render models work well together with controller-inferred hand tracking. In fact, this is the only way to accurately position hands in relationship to controllers, as only the XR runtime is aware of the dimensions and button positions of the controller. Unless, of course, you don't use physical controller models or target a fixed number of platforms. Open up Project Settings again. We need to enable our hand tracking extension. We also need to enable our controller data source. We can enable our unobstructed data source so we also get hand tracking data when we are not holding a controller. I've enabled all three for our demonstration. Hand tracking is using its own trackers, so we need to add an XR node 3D node to our origin node. Here we select the left hand tracker from our tracker dropdown list. I also always turn on Show and Tracked, so we only show our hand model when we have tracking data. Next, we give our node a better name. Now we repeat these steps for our right hand as well. As I often do, I place these nodes somewhere sensible, but this is only for visualization. OpenXR will position these nodes in runtime. We do have pre-made hands that we'll use. You can find these in Godot's official hand tracking demo. So we simply drag these assets onto the correct nodes. And now we have some hands, but they do not yet work. For this, right-click on the hand asset and enable editable children. And then add a new node to the skeleton 3D node. The node we want is called XR Hand Modifier 3D. By default, it's already correct for our left hand. We also want to update the full bones, so we leave this as is. Now we repeat this on our right hand, but change the tracker to the right hand tracker. There is one more step, and again, not all XR runtimes support this, but we need to specify that we don't want to make a fist, but that our hand tracking should conform to our controller. It doesn't really matter where we run this code, so we'll just add a script to our main node. In our ready function, we'll quickly obtain our OpenXR interface. We then use setMotionRange for each hand to set our motion range to conform to controller. Now we can see that our hands are properly placed on our controllers and our fingers interact with it. This includes fingers being placed on the buttons when detection is supported by the hardware. Finally, there are scenarios where we want to have more control over the placement or visibility of our render models. We may want to prevent the user from moving their hands through a wall, or we may want to hide our controller model when the user is holding a virtual object. Our render model manager, however, handles every model. We can connect the signals to become aware of new render models being added, but often it's easier to break things up. Our render model manager has a tracker property, as our render models can be related to a tracker. This allows us to filter which render models we want to include. In our drop-down list, we can see that we can select the left hand to include only render models related to our left hand, or select right hand. The default is all. Finally, we have a non-set option that shows anything that isn't related to our hands. We'll select non-set here, as we'll be handling the render models for our hands separately. You may wish to remove this node altogether if you only want to show the render models related to the player's hands. We currently have our hand trackers and our controller trackers separate. As our render models are related to our controller trackers, we'll build on those. Just as an example, I'll add a new render model manager node to our left hand controller. On this new node, we set the tracker to our left hand. We also need to correct the positioning, as currently our manager assumes we are in our origin space, not in our controller space. Note that our left hand controller node is set to the grip pose. We just also need to use the grip pose on our manager. Ignore the warning, it will clear on reload. Setting things up like this does not change anything around the positioning of our render models, but we have now isolated our render models related to our left hand, and we can thus simply hide or show our manager node to hide or show these models. In order to prevent our controller from moving through a wall, we need some more logic. For this, I have prepared a few scripts beforehand. Our first script implements a new node called XR Collision Hand 3D. Each physics frame, we attempt to move this node to where its parent is currently placed. When using a child node for our controller node, it will follow the controller around, but stop when it collides with an object. We'll add this node to our left controller node. We need to add a collision shape to this. For now, we'll use a box shape that we size to encompass our hand. You could implement something more accurate, but that is a topic for a different video. Now we drag our render model manager and make it a child node of our collision hand node. We can now copy these three nodes by selecting our collision hand node, pressing Ctrl-C, selecting our right hand controller node, and pressing Ctrl-V. We do need to change the tracker on the render model manager for the right hand. With this setup, our render models should no longer pass through walls. However, our hand meshes are unaffected by this change. We could duplicate this solution on our hand trackers, but it will be difficult to sync up the movement as the hand node collides independently from the controller node. For this, I've created a new script that implements the XR Hand Pose Offset 3D node. This node determines the offset between the controller grip pose and the hand tracking pose. In our ready function, we obtain our related controller node. As you can see, we go down the ancestry tree to find this. This node is designed to add to our collision hand node. In our process function, we'll hide our node if we didn't find a controller. Now we check the tracker of our controller node. If it's the left hand, we use the left hand tracker. If it's the right hand, we'll use the right-hand tracker, else we again hide our node. Next, we obtain our hand tracker. If this was unsuccessful, or if we don't have tracking data, we again make our node invisible. Now we can obtain our pose and get the hand tracker's transform in the origin node space. We can now make our node visible and calculate our offset by taking the inverse of our controller transform and multiplying that with our hand tracker transform. Now we can add our offset node to our collision hands node. Next, we drag our hand offset from our hand tracker node to our offset node. Note that if you didn't place the tracker nodes in the same place, you may need to zero out the transform on the root of our asset. We can now repeat this process for the right hand. While we do this, we also remove the hand tracker nodes. And with that, our setup should be completed. Now, as I try and move my hands through the wall here, I'm being stopped. And that's all there is to it. As always, if you found this useful, please give this video a like. See you next time.